Well, welcome to the Shih Tzu of Minnesota virtual reunion. Another great interview today. I can't wait to have you meet and talk to Debbie Iverson. She's on the board, but she has a special place in my heart because I just took on being a foster. She was my mentor, and I tell you, I couldn't have done it without her. So I have a special place for Debbie and Cookie, who is the most adorable dog that in the whole wide world. And Debbie will tell you that, and so will Cookie.
Yes.
So welcome.
Wondering why you didn't thank her for mentoring you.
Oh, right. Yeah, she was a big piece of the mentoring process too. So tell us, Debbie, how did you get involved with this rescue?
Well, I got involved many years ago when we first began, when there was a group of us that was with another rescue, and it was based in another state. And we really wanted our dogs to stay in the area here, and we wanted to work with people in the area here. And at the one particular point, I had a dog that had some cancer, and people wanted me to adopt her to someone in Illinois, and I just couldn't do it. So with the encouragement of some wonderful people like Martha Koyman and Phyllis Ettinger and Kathy Diamond, we all decided, there was about, I think maybe 10 of us decided we wanted to start our own rescue. And so that's how I became involved.
Wow.
And, We had some other people outside of our rescue that helped us also. And so we got started, and we have a really great team of people.
I will echo.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I guess at this point, I just want to say before people turn me off here, I have to thank all the wonderful adopters that I have who, you know, keep in such good touch with me, and I get to see their dog sometimes, and you've experienced that now, Cheryl, that's a bond you have with those people that, you know, is just really tremendous. And also all the people in our rescue, the old, you know, old farts like me who've been around forever, and then the new ones that we have that are like you that are coming in with great ideas. And I mean, it's just a really tremendous group of people.
You know, I would echo that. That's certainly what I've experienced.
And of course, the dogs. The dogs are the very best.
Yeah. And they are so all over, right? They're mm-hmm. from puppies to seniors mm-hmm. to perfectly healthy to abused to.
Right. Oh, yes.
To needing significant health considerations.
Right.
So
right.
whatever they are, the rescue is willing to take them on and do what
yes.
needs to be done.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And my love, I would say, I mean, I've always had a fondness for dogs that maybe have a health issue. Mm-hmm. And so like my last foster dog that had a health issue was Ruby. And she came to us with a really gigantic bladder stone and some other smaller ones. And she was very, very meek and tired when I got her. I thought, oh, she's just a real chill dog. And then we got her squared away, her health, you know, taken care of, hopefully. And she was adopted by a wonderful couple. And she walks like 5 miles a day now with her adopter. I mean, she's just a go-getter now because she's feeling good. So, you know, that's pretty exciting when you have a dog like that. And they go from being so, you know, kind of blah to watching TV.
Yeah.
That particular dog liked to watch TV, so.
Well, I know, you know, COVID obviously impacted the picnic, the reunion that mm-hmm. we have every year. You know, what do you see for the future with the rescue, and where are things now?
Well, as you said, with COVID, it's really quite, it's unique, although it's an opportunity for us also because we have had to adjust in doing some things differently, like the reunion, you know, and it's certainly, we certainly hope to go back to the in-person reunion because seeing all those dogs and their owners together is just, it's really dynamic. And it's just, it's one of the things that I think keeps our foster parents especially going. Mm-hmm. And right now we're not getting a lot of dogs into rescue because people are home with their dogs and can care for them and, you know, maybe work on training a little more. I'm sure when things go back more to normal, then we'll start to see more dogs again.
Yeah. You know,
so in the meantime, we hope to, you know, just keep plugging away. Oh, there's a bark.
There's a bark. Yeah.
I love it.
We have a dog in my house doing some dog sitting for the week here. So, So we're not seeing a lot of dogs. And I think sometimes that's frustrating when people are looking to adopt.
You know, Cheryl, I do the applications for our rescue. And when we have a dog, well, like your last foster dog, mm-hmm. I mean, within a couple days, I'll have 40, 50 applications. And people want a dog so badly. And it just breaks my heart to have to tell them, you know, no to their application. It's not because it's a good one. It's just might not be the right one for that particular dog. Mm-hmm. And we do always think of the dog first, you know, in terms of, you know, if it's a dog maybe who has some separation anxiety and really needs to have someone home with them. Or some dogs need another dog in their home. Some dogs, you know, they just have different needs. And so we always, it's really hard sometimes for people to understand that, but we do always think of the dog first.
Yeah, that's true.
And I wish I had a dog for all those great applicants because there are so many good ones out there.
Yeah. Good. So where do you see the rescue going in the future? Obviously, hopefully we get through COVID and we can reconnect. Is there any plans or ideas?
Well, right now what we're trying to do is we have had a few more volunteer applications during this time. And we're trying to, you know, we know some people want to volunteer just because they're home now, but they might go back to work and be gone 10 hours a day. And that's kind of a hard thing for fostering. Mm-hmm. But maybe they can help in other ways. But right now we do have some new foster parents we're pursuing. And we don't have dogs for them at this point, but because our process is such that we do check mm-hmm. references, we do a home visit, and then hopefully get people all set to go. So that when we do have a dog for them, you know, they're ready to go. So we're trying to do some of those things now when we're not so busy with intaking dogs and that sort of thing. Mm-hmm. And we hope to eventually get back to our meet and greets at Petco, mm-hmm. Which are the first Saturday of every month, because that's such a great way for us to meet applicants. But we just we can't do that now. The store won't let us. So
yeah.
But we're just trying to adjust.
That's right. And there's always work to do, mm-hmm. even when we don't have the dogs and we can't quite do what it is that we want. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Is there anything you want to wrap up with telling our listeners?
Gosh, no, just thanks to everybody. Like I say, to all our wonderful adopters and to you for organizing this. And we have, you know, like I say, especially to our great team of people who are part of our organization. I mean, they're like family to all of us and to me now. And it's just a thrill to, to be able to be part of this organization.
Yeah. I've been a part of it for a short time, but everything you say is exactly what I experienced.
Oh, good. Good. Well, we're happy to have you.
Yeah, well, I'm delighted to be here. So thank you, Debbie and Cookie, for giving us your time today. Yeah, it's been
a great
interview.
She's leaving now already.
Yeah, she said, I'm done with you guys. All right, thanks again.
Thanks.